Carter. This is the Barnstable County Regional Government. We are the Regional Board of Regional County Commissioners. It is July 18th, 2018. We have been agendaed to start at 10 a.m. in the morning, and it is exactly 10 a.m. in the morning by the clock on the wall. We are located at the County Commissioners Meeting Room at the Superior Courthouse at 3195 Main Street in Barnstable, Massachusetts. I'm officially calling the meeting to order. If you could all please join me in rise and pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you could all please remain standing just for a quick moment of silence for those that all died in service of our country. So prayer for those that are currently serving our country. And I'd like to also add prayers to the families of the lost police officer. Yet again, another one. And this has got to stop. Okay, thank you all very much. First on our agenda is public comment. I don't see anyone here from the public, but I'll ask officially, is there anyone here from the public? Hearing nothing, I can skip over our usual explanation to the public. Let's see now. No, she's county employee, unfortunately.
Right, I know.
Okay, now. That brings us to number five on our agenda, approval of minutes. I'd be looking for someone to approve the regular session meeting minutes of July 11th, 2018 as presented.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
For the record, as I read these motions, many of the motions that I read are positive motions. I'm just going to remind my fellow commissioners that at any time if you have a either a negative motion or a non-positive motion, all you have to do is just let me know once I read it and we can change the language. As you guys know, I like to have all our motions in writing. So I presume that things like minutes and a lot of these contracts are positive. But at any time, or if you want to postpone, you guys are certainly within your rights to just say that, and then we'll change the motion that way. Six is general business. I put this on the agenda because I'm constantly being asked at the Assembly Delegates meetings where we stand. And quite frankly, we're coming up to the beginning of the new AmeriCorps program. So this is a presentation and really an open discussion regarding the housing for AmeriCorps. Just to update my fellow commissioners, we decided not to use the current house in Bourne, I'll refer to it as, a number of different structural and safety reasons to house 15 members. And I may use numbers, I might be off by one or two, but you'll get the general concept. Through some work with staff, and certainly Jack's office, and Steve gets a good kudos on this, we were able to, subsequently when we knew we weren't going to be able to put the 15 there, we reduced our number of AmeriCorps members this year by 10, which would have made us only have to find five dwellings. The old Gosnell house across the street from this place has come available now, and we have had, and I believe we are approved for and are moving forward with six in that particular home. That would have alleviated any controversy or any problems with the housing issues. However, we were notified mid-spring that the federal government with their, and I may be using the improper terms, but their fire corps was no longer going to be participating in the AmeriCorps program, and I believe they had six members, and they provided the housing for those six. So with those six members not having housing, that put the pressure on the county to now go out and try to find some additional housing. I know, Ron, you were working on a number of different sites, and because of open meeting laws, you and I have not discussed this behind closed doors. I don't know what's going on with what you have been able to secure, and certainly we have AmeriCorps here so they can give us an update, and I thought Steve was going to be joining us too, but maybe he'll come in later. But maybe you can give us an update on what you may have discovered for these five positions that we are looking for housing for.
Well, I think it's better to have Dan come up, who's the coordinator, okay, because he's been hands-on. He's got the most up-to-date information available. But I'm constantly going to him to get updates. So,
so Dan, if you come up, I appreciate it.
Shell.
Yep. And again, for the record, I have not had any correspondence with you, Dan, on this issue. Again, it's we try to tredge the line very carefully on the open meeting law, but your correspondence with another commissioner and then subsequently telling me what he thinks is a chain open meeting law violation, and I believe we have not, and I wanted for the record that we have, you and I haven't spoken anyhow on this issue.
So just to backtrack to sort of talk about the numbers, I just want to sort of make sure we're all on the same page here. So right now we have 32 members, and that's how we've been for the last 6 years since we added on the fire corps. So right now we've got 13 members out at the LaHack House, which is owned by the Seashore, 6 members, which is the fire corps, out in what we call the Wells House, owned by the Seashore, and then 13 in the Bourne House. And in addition to those members, we have a supervisor in each of those three houses, so 3 staff members. So we were asked to drop down to 24 members, which the natural solution there was to eliminate the fire corps, and that was really a mutual decision between us looking to reduce the size and with the Seashore, Dave Curry, the fire management officer. We haven't been able to sort of make our schedules line up perfectly. The fire season runs different than the federal grant season, so that hasn't lined up perfectly for him. And in addition, he's looking to do more research-based stuff, especially with the pine beetle moving up north. So fire corps went away. The housing that he has is designated for fire service members. As we're not going to have a fire corps, we aren't allowed to use that house. And in addition, with the Bourne House going away, we're looking for housing for those 12 members, because we're dropping from 13 to 12 for that house. So with Gosnold, that takes away 6 of the housing need for 6 members. And our hope is to also put the supervisor there. And the other option that we're looking at exploring, we're working with the town of Barnstable to use the old Sheriff's Youth Ranch in West Barnstable. We're pretty hopeful that that's going to pan out and have 6 members there, 6 in the old Gosnold House and a supervisor, and then 12 and a supervisor out at the LaHack House.
In Wellfleet.
And another reason that the Wells House wouldn't really work out for us, let alone that we don't sort of meet the criteria to use it anymore, is that we're trying to keep the core balanced to have 12 on the Upper Cape and 12 on the Outer Cape. If we had 18 members out in Wellfleet, we would have a major loss of services to Falmouth, to Mashpee, to Bourne, to Sandwich, because we'd only have 6 members. For folks to drive from Wellfleet daily out to Falmouth is just not reasonable on $6,000 stipend that they receive a year. So that's where we're at.
When do you think we'll know on, I'm going to refer to as my fellow commissioners and your, you're referring it to, is it the Sheriff's Youth Ranch? Is that where this other dwelling is?
Yeah. Yes.
When do you think you'll know definitively how we're able to move forward with that? And if, and I know I'm going to be asked this today at the assembly, so I want to be able to have something to go back on it.
Yeah.
What does it look like? I mean, I know, we know definitively that the Gosnell House is a go, and we're going to take due, and we've already, Jack has already instructed staff to start making some general cleanup or whatever to get it ready. So we know that's a go. How definitively, or when will we know if the Sheriff Youth Ranch House is going to be a plus or not?
And when was the last time you spoke with David Anthony with the town of Barnstable, I think?
Yeah, we spoke Monday of this week. And the only thing that's sort of holding things up is getting DPW out there to inspect the septic system to see sort of what load that it could take. So it looks like we're going to be able to use it no matter what. I hesitate to say that because we don't have a physical contract yet, but they are working on that. And in addition, it sounds like that would really only impede the amount of members that we could house there. It could be minimum of 4, but it sounds like up to 8 they would let us. But realistically, I think 6 is a good number. It's a 3-bedroom, 1-bath.
And just to add, they asked you for documentation showing that AmeriCorps is a governmental entity which allows you to be, obtain some exemption so you can have the increased number of persons, right?
Exactly, yeah. So Jack wrote up a letter and we sent along just our grant agreement that we have for this year and our proposal for next year to hopefully sort of move that discussion along.
Sorry. I don't even know how to shut the damn thing off. Shut up. Can I just add one thing?
Mm-hmm.
In regards to the septic system, in case there is any kind of a situation out there, we should not lose sight of the fact that we would probably install a tight tank to get us through a year and just pay for the extra pumping service. We certainly don't want to do anything that's going to not meet, Title V or groundwater standards. We want to set the pace here. We don't want to be doing things just because we're exempt for it.
Yep.
But a tight tank situation is certainly something that could get us through a year too.
Yeah.
And it might cost us a little bit in pumping fees, but better that than putting in maybe a whole new Title V septic system, unless we decide we're going to have a long-term relationship there.
Well, just on that issue, we were pleasantly surprised. Steve and Sean went out to the Gosnell building to take a look at the septic system out there the other day, or the wastewater treatment system out there the other day, and they were surprised that it was in such good shape. Our plan had been to have George put an innovative treatment system out at Gosnell. We don't need to. We could take that same technology and move it to Barnstable if Barnstable's okay with that on a relatively quick basis. We have an alternative to help Dan out if that becomes the solution. Sean and I talked about it at length yesterday. He was going to run it by George today. So,
thank you.
Well, Dan, the only thing I'll add then is as soon as you get some information on this, because this is a priority for the commissioners, we're being pressured on it, and I certainly don't want to say anything that's misleading or wrong. But as soon as you move forward in this and get some information, if you can let Jack know, or Ron know, and then Ron can let Jack know, but I'd like to re-put this back on the agenda again.
Yep.
I don't want to put it on if there's no update, because there's no need to have you come in for that.
Right.
But certainly, once there is a final update and a final solution, I think it would be nice if we could get it out to the public.
Yep, absolutely.
Dan, you're presenting to the Assembly of Delegates today, too. You're on their agenda, right?
Yeah.
So they'll be up to
date. Yeah, we'll be up there.
As well.
Yeah.
No, you're going to take the heat instead of me.
Yeah, we'll take it for you. Yeah.
I won't throw you under the bus if you don't throw me under the bus. How's that for
that? Sounds good, yeah.
Okay. All right, is there anything else on this then?
No, but I'm really glad to see that it's moving along.
Yeah,
it is.
Excellent. Thank you for all your work.
Yeah, thank you very much. Good, I appreciate it.
Thanks.
The next on our agenda is a discussion regarding the issues of the request for proposals on the county farm. Just to update my fellow commissioners, first of all, let me hand you out. I'm going to just hand you the county farm. This is kind of some of my thoughts. I think in your packet, you got the draft RFP, which was a packet like this that had some maps in it, too. Okay. Just to give you a brief update and also the public an update, the county farm lease is up. This was initially I believe the term was 3 years, and then he got an extension which brought the whole thing out to 10. Yeah, so and it's up in January. After reviewing the, and for full disclosure here by the way too, the original lease that went out 10 years ago, I was not affiliated with the county. I was the president of Farm Bureau. I was asked to serve on the RFP review committee as the president of Farm Bureau. I was not on the Assembly of Delegates, and I was not a county commissioner. So now, fast forward 10 years later, I'm a sitting county commissioner, and the lease has come up again. This does not have language for a renewal situation. This needs to go out for an RFP. And it needs to go out so that all the general public can have an opportunity to either bid or have interest in this. Having background in this and knowing it from, again, my previous involvement as the president of Farm Bureau, I don't particularly care for the lease going out for the entire 98 acres. There's 98 acres out there, and the numbers I'm going to give, and the public needs to know this, my fellow commissioners need to know this, again, don't hold me to them by points. If there's 98 acres, that's enough. If there's 96 or 97.2, I don't want to hear that I'm exaggerating or whatever. There's 98 acres out there, roughly. We lease the entire 98 acres minus the use of one building in the lease, which was the old house that now houses some of the members of the cooperative extension. But the language gave the leasee, person out to the farmer, the rights to the entire property, including a number of the different buildings. I do not believe that that approach is in the best interest of the county at this time. I have been approached by staff. Many of them have some ideas to use not only fields, but a number of buildings out there for purposes here within the county itself, through the exchange exchange department. So, I came up with a method, and please, for today's discussion, understand this is only how we're going to put this out in an RFP. How are we, the county, going to present it to people to be able to bid on it? Basically, in front of you, we have today two methods. One is just put it out as 98 acres, do it again the same way it was, which I would not support. The second one that you have before you is to actually break the property up into fields. And I'm going to get up for a minute because you have this on paper, but I did put it on the board so I can make it easier for me to explain. This entire red area represents the 98 acres. This red line right here is the railroad bed that divides it. Just for a point of going. What I did, and staff actually helped with this too, is these F and green areas, they're basically fields, literally fields, where someone could plant something. Field 1, 2, 3, field 5, and field 4. Field 4, the county has interest in, so we are actually taking this one out of the RFP, because the county wants to use that at this time.
What's it being used for now?
There's some trees out there, and it's a small tree farm.
No, F4 is hydrangeas and blueberry bushes. They're not
so
active.
So the extension service utilizes it?
The tenant occasionally.
I've seen it, so I knew there was trees being grown there. For
some no, that's actually a different field.
That's a different one, okay.
This is the one. Sorry.
That's one of the problems, Ron, yeah, with what the question you just asked, yeah, is because of the way the lease that we're operating under right now is written and was offered, there's this really gray area of the lease or actually has legal control over it. Yet the county threw a couple of, I'm not using it, you can use it. So there's been this kind of a
verbal agreement,
almost shared situation, which in a municipality is not good. Right. It's one thing. I mean, I wouldn't do it on my farm. I'm certainly not going to suggest that the county do it. You know,
which underscores why we should do it the way you're outlining.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So let's just go back to the fields for a minute. 1, 2, 3, and 5 look like they could go out. There's also a question about field 8 in the background, in the back lot, which I suggest should go out also. The rest of this area out here, I think we should leave right now under county control, because there's some talk of a lot of things. I dare to say it, because, you know, when you say something, it's like, oh my God, they're doing this there. All I'm going to say is county use. There's some ideas that are coming up that the county and county staff may want to do there. Let's go to the buildings real quick. Right here in blue, you'll see all these buildings. And also, I'm sorry, the blue is greenhouses. There's 1, 2, 3, 4 greenhouses. I did not get a chance to talk about staff with this or not, but in my proposal that I gave you, it would be my probably feelings to put all the greenhouses out under one parcel, if you will. Be kind of, I think it's kind of nuts to have five people in there running five different operations and five greenhouses. So in my proposal that I have in front of you, it's to include all these greenhouses as one parcel.
Can I have a question?
Yeah.
Just so I can get my bearings with this. Where on this diagram, for example, is the current extension service?
Just building right here that's in red.
Okay, there. It's up there. Okay.
Right. That's why I
gave
it
in red. A better idea of what we could try.
Yeah.
Right, and the beekeeper's storage.
That would be over here. That's why these buildings are in red, because I do not intend, or I, again, in my thoughts, I don't want to see any of these buildings. This is the big old barn that's out there. I think that should remain under our control. This is a Quonset hut that's being used by our emergency management people.
Yeah.
This is a garage that's being used now. Again, it's all kind of mixed up. This is a lean-to that has some of the farmers' stuff in there. I think all that should be brought back into the control of the county, you know? So that's why those are not intended to be out in the lane. Okay. So again, the greenhouses, I think, should go out as one parcel, if you will. These ones in black are the farm stand buildings. There's a number of buildings, I think there's four of them. Again, I don't see the need to separate those, and I didn't get a chance to talk about staff with this, but I think, again, one bidder, one person should be in control of those buildings, because you're not going to, you know, it's just not big enough, you know. So for this exercise here, you know, again, these would go out as another parcel. The solar field, the way I wrote it up in my draft is that I believe that the solar field should be owned by the county, yet we would work out with whoever got the greenhouses, because, and I keep looking at the staff over here, but is not the solar field connected to the greenhouses?
Yeah, we need to find out more about that, right. But yeah, they're all connected.
So I think if we retained ownership of the literal solar field itself, then we could work out in the agreement with whoever won the bid on the units that the solar field feeds, that they would benefit as well as the county.
So that's an existing solar field.
Yes, it is. It's a small field,
yeah,
but it's still, it's still a question. With that, I'm going to just run up to the back two buildings. There is a shared building, and the reason why I say it's shared is because I think that's where the well is.
Electricity. Electricity.
Right, electricity. So that one can't be leased. Needs to be clear that that's ours, and we will work out a shared agreement with the user. This building 14 and 15, I think they're referred to as poultry buildings. I think they should go out separately. And then F8 I mentioned with the front fields. There's also a compost pad. I don't think, and again, this is something we can discuss, I don't believe that the compost pad should go out in the RFP as a lease. I think we should try to draft some shared language so that the county will be responsible for it. But if a bidder bids on a number of these fields and has a tractor and wants to have a deal with us to use a compost pad and turn it over and maintain it and make sure it's being operated properly, then we should be able to do that. Having it go out separately is dangerous, because we don't want people bringing in material from that's not being generated from that site, because you don't know where they're bringing it from and who's dropping it off. And it's also just a liability thing of who's watching it and who's maintaining it.
So each one of these fields is a separate, distinct RFP?
No.
No.
The way we're going to put the RFP out is we're going to put the RFP out just like this map. And we're going to say, you have to bid a technical proposal and a cost proposal on anything that you're interested in. If you're interested in field one, then you'd put a technical proposal and a cost proposal on field one.
Okay.
If you're interested in one, two, and three, you would bring three technical proposals and three cost proposals. The reason why I advocate that system is, and just so that we don't get into this and make it even more confusing, the terms of the lease, I think, should be 3 years with three-year extensions. Now, Leo leases field one, field two, and field three. I pay the county $500 a year for each one of these. That's $1,500. 3 years goes by. I come to the county and I say, I want to stay there, but you know what? Field one is horrible. It's rocky, it's wet, I don't like it. I don't want one anymore.
So you can amend it.
So all the county has to say is, fine, we're going to extend your agreement for F2 and F3. We already have the cost proposals. So all we're going to do is minus whatever you said you were going to give us for F1. Very simple. Also, for the county, let's say the county ends up doing something with F4. And we decide to put in a replacement small grown trees for the replacing along the road program. And the county has interest in F3. 3 years go by, the first extension comes up, the county can say, Leo, we love what you did, you're a great guy, we did a wonderful job there, but you know what? We want F3. The county wants to retain field three. So you know what? If you want an extension, we'll give you an extension, but it's going to be for F1 and F2.
Flexibility.
It's a flexible way for both parties as we move forward.
So there's nothing really to prevent the current tenant if it's there to put in a bid for some of these separate
absolutely not. Absolutely not. The current tenant has all the legal rights, just like any resident does, to build on any of these. One more thing. Again, I know this gets into the weeds, but if you have to understand procurement law, if this goes out under an RFP, the procurement law states that we have a rating system. I would suggest that in that rating system that we probably look more advantageously towards less applicants. In other words, if Leo comes in and says, I want F1, 2, 3, building 14, 15, and an F8, and I'm prepared to give you $100 for each one of those a year, I'm one person, and then we have 6 other individuals come in and bid $150 for each one of them. I think it would be more advantageous for the county to have one tenant at a little less money than 6 tenants at a little more money. So when we do the RFP, I do believe the language of the criteria and how we rate them should be in there. And again, this is all in that draft paper that I sent out to you. Real simple, but it's something that allows us to look at somebody and say, okay, do you have history? Are you a farmer? Do you have experience? Do you have the correct licenses? And you want all of these, and it's a little cheaper than if we did, again, 8 other individuals. I just don't think having 8 tenants is a smart move. So
what you're saying is the bid would be for the entire parcel, including.
It could be. But this method allows people to say, I don't want all this. I just want F8.
It allows it to be broken up.
Yeah, I understand. But if that's not the desire, or if it's not the optional result, wouldn't it be better to just bid it as one parcel?
It's not better to bid it as one parcel, because then we'll be in the same position we are today, which is a question on what the lessee owns and has a right to, and what the leaseor owns and has a right
to.
So
if we would...
And if we want in the future to take any section out, mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know, maybe 3 years from now, building 14 and 15 may be desired by our extension services. Right. They might say, hey, listen, whoever the county commissioners are here at the time, say, we got this great plan, we want to go in there, we want to do this, this, and this, and that. This 3-year extension allows us to say to whoever's leasing it, 14 and 15 might be leased by one person, and field 1, 2, and 3 might be leased by someone else.
So even our preference would be one tenant, we would consider
Absolutely. Multiple
tenants.
Absolutely. So and by multiple, I think that my intentions would be, you know, yeah, to have somebody like, it's also logistics and how this works out, to have someone lease field 1, 2, 3, and 5, and the farm stand, and the greenhouses, and then have a completely other different person have F8, that's not bad. You know, that's not bad, because again, we want to see what they want to use it for too. Because also in there, and this gets in the weeds, and I put a lot of work into this. Mm. Organic farming obviously would be something that we would look more advantageous towards in ranking. But if we had an organic farmer in one field 1, 2, 3, and 5, and we had a non-organic farmer in field 8, we need to have in their language that this non-organic farmer in field 8 is going to do everything within his power under good agricultural practices to make sure he doesn't jeopardize the certification of this person who is an organic farmer.
Bless you.
Bless you. Because there's just ways that, of crossing over and crossing by fields, which could in fact jeopardize his organic certification.
So no matter what, the purpose must be agricultural for any of the fields.
Absolutely. Now, two things, agricultural number one, and number two, you'll notice again in my notes, we will not advocate, or at least to anyone who's going to grow any product that is not legal under federal and state guidelines.
So no marijuana?
No marijuana.
Okay. I had to say it.
So today again, I basically am just looking for a consensus of my fellow commissioners that this is the way you want to go. I do not think, and maybe if you do want to see the RFP before it goes out, you can ask to have a copy. But I would think that with this information and staff here, Elaine Davis isn't here, but she worked hard on this too. She's our procurement officer. That I have enough faith in them that if we let them know this is the direction that we want to go, that they would be able to put it together and put it out.
So Leo, the rear part of the property that will remain under county control, approximately how many acres is that?
You have a map in there.
I'll double check it.
I think this is 5, so 18?
There's 12 of open field, and then there's some probably 40 of wooded area.
So it's 50 something.
About 50 acres.
Yeah, 50 yeah.
Would still be.
Acres, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
The only other thing I would say is that I would really like to see the RFP before.
Do you want me to gender it again?
Yeah, I think it would be a good idea to review it.
At this time, because his lease doesn't run out until January, February, anyway.
No, but he needs to know.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. And there's a history with the farm, and I mean, many years. So we should really see what's included in it.
Any questions from the audience?
I just want to note on that, so you all understand that it's going to be advertised in the Central Register for 30 days before you open any bids. Mm-hmm. So it's a process. So we'll get it to you as
I'll put this on the agenda next week. I think we're real close to having
a draft of it.
Yeah, we'll get you a draft this Friday.
So maybe like 2 weeks or something?
I think I can put it up next week. Yeah. I'd like to see it move forward.
Yeah. Russ is,
and again, this paper that I handed out to you guys, mm-hmm. that's the consensus of my presentation today, and that's basically just going to be translated into a legal document with all the bulletproof language as far as, you know, the requirements of insurance and COLA and all that, you know, and dates and things like that. So the RFP itself is just going to take pretty much what I have there and fold it into the bulletproof, bullet plate legal document. Yeah.
Yep. Russ Norton from the Extension, we're fortunate to have him. He certainly has the background and experience in this field to provide Elaine with the technical support that she needs on critical issues. So between the two of them, they'll be able to wrap it up consistent with what Leo suggests.
I wanted to add three, Mike McGuire, Director of Extension Service, just three quick notes that came up. Leo, I think when you said 3 3-year extensions, I think you were including the first, right?
No, so two 3-year extensions.
Yep. Yeah, so it'd be one and then two extensions,
right, 9 years
for
total.
9 total.
Right. Okay, you're right. Thank you.
Getting into the weeds, the only two issues I need to iron out with Russ are that solar field solar field
here.
It is linked to the greenhouses that was built by the tenant, but the county is.
Is it behind the farm stand?
It is. Yeah,
and it's between the farm stand and that field that kind of like park up against that field there.
Yeah.
So it's.
I got to work this out. I'm going to find out more details about how it's linked and, it's going to be our property, but we just got to get the details worked out on that. And the other thing is a compost pad is a state-permitted compost pad. The current tenant holds that permit, so I want to get some more details from Russ about how the legalities of us becoming the licensed agent that
and
is,
Russ is the current
maintaining.
Tenant.
Maintaining.
Yeah.
No, because we do, I think Russ has got, he's got a lot of the background on it. We just, there are some details that we can work out between now and the next meeting about that pad, but that's the other piece I want to know, so.
That's why I didn't include them in the RFP either, because my intentions, and again, what we do not include in this RFP that's going to go out, in this method, the way we're doing it, does not mean that after they work out issues and questions on other things, we cannot issue a RFP about that particular area. Staff and I went back and forth on F8. I didn't particularly think that F8 should be included this round. However, I acquiesced to their intelligence and their involvement in this and said, okay, fine, let's put it out. But the way this is set up, and if we can, I know I'm driving Elaine Davis crazy, but once we get this system in the computer to pull out different parcels and to go back out again for different leases, I think will make it a lot easier.
So I need a clarification, and I'm sorry if I'm showing some ignorance here. So you said Russ holds the permit for
No, the tenant.
The tenant holds the
compost pad. The current tenant actually received a federal grant to put the compost pad in, but it's our property now, so.
Somehow that has to transition over to the county.
Most federal grants, again, and I don't, most federal grants done for farmers that hold leases on property include very distinct and clear language that once that lease expires or the leasee is evicted for some reason, the owner comes in and takes over the benefit of that grant. Anyone that I've received, and I've received a number of them on lease properties that I have, including upgrades to pump systems and drainage systems and things like that. The town always had to sign off because they own the land. So I'm sure, I would doubt very much that.
No, we just, I want to, between this meeting and the next meeting, I got to get the details worked out, that's all.
Great.
I have another question. Yes. How many leases are there on the property?
Right now there's only one.
The one, that's what I thought.
But this system could open up, realistically, you might have two or three different responders here, maybe. I don't see us coming up with it. Someone doing, I use the example of each individual leasing, but I just don't see that as happening.
Would it be possible for one lessee to have subleases?
No.
Or no?
We're not.
Not going there.
I explicitly put language in there because that the county loses the control over who's on the property, which creates issues. So.
That's I'm just wanting to clarify.
Yeah. Yes, Ron.
Yeah, and the way things are currently structured, the county's not really making any revenue from the property.
Currently, she does not pay any revenue to the county, no.
There were some improvements made, but I would ask you both, Commissioner Kakunis and I have spoken on this. If you have any questions, there's lots of details, some of which you may or may not want to know. But the economics is one piece of this, and then the community benefit of the farm and how many folks are employed there is another piece, and we can talk. We don't need to do that here, but if you need that information, I'm happy to provide that for you.
I mean, I haven't been there in quite a while, so maybe, Mike, I could contact you and get a quick tour.
Anytime you want to go over there.
Don't promise anything to the current leasee, though.
No.
The current leasee is going to have to go through the RFP process, just like everyone else.
Yeah.
So just be careful if you go down and...
No,
what's happening there now, no matter what, ends in January.
Yeah,
and a new RFP situation has to take place.
Yep.
In January.
May end up being the winner, but we cannot say that. Definite. So. Anything else on this?
No.
Any members of the public have any, I know our fellow staff members out there have anything on this? No, Steve, you don't want to add anything to it, you're all set. Okay,
so
then I think we're just going to move forward. I won't take a motion. I know we tried to
get out this.
We'll bring an actual draft document back and present it.
Would you like me to come to the assembly this afternoon and talk about it? No? You good? Okay.
Is it, it's not on their agenda, is it?
No, it'll be under my report, and I'm just gonna give a general report on what we're doing, and you know, the consensus of the board, and how we're moving forward with it. No, I don't need to do that.
Okay.
They don't have any input on the RFP, they have input on the lease itself.
Okay.
But I will give them an update on how we are preparing to go out for the RFP, so they'll know.
Thank you.
Right, thank you very much. All right. Did I leave my glasses over there? Nope, get them in my pocket. Don't look far around. I found them. All right, now, second handout that I have for you is a list of potential members to be appointed to the Barnstable County Coastal Management Committee. I am not prepared to act on this today. I want you to take this list home and just think about it. But next week, I do believe that I will have a formal recommendation for you. Again, you can let me get on the list anyhow and explain it to you. The top sections are basically the county department heads and the people that are listed actually in the ordinance that created this. The Cape Cod Commission has a representative, and I'm glad Mike's still here. The Cooperative Extension has a representative. I at this time suggest that we put the two department heads. This is for the Barnstable County Coastal Management Committee. Mm-hmm. They can, at any time, if they find this is too much, step down, but then they would have a nominee from their department. But right now, I think it would be good to get this going to just have the two department heads. Mass Bay's service provider, which is the Association of Preservation of Cape Cod, does have a spot on this board. I do not have a name to plug in there, so I would like to contact them and have them give us who they would like to serve. Barnstable County Commissioners, that's us. We have a spot on the board. I would love to do it, but I do not have the time to do it. So I put over here on the corner, it would be my suggestion, and this is what I want you to think about, that if neither one of you have the time to do it, then maybe we consider Steve Tebow. He's our assistant administrator. He also runs the dredge, so I think it'd be a good asset to this committee.
I think Steve is a good choice, but I have an interest in...
Yeah, well, this is, again, well, you can, you know, we can make these decisions as we go down the road. Assembly of Delegates has a position on this. John Ullman has contacted me. I will bring this up at the assembly meeting today. I don't want to overstep the speaker's ability to appoint, but I will let her know that John Ullman has reached out to me. I will tell John to reach out to her. Then we can move his name over into the line if that happens. The next are suggested members. They are going to be on a staggered 3-year term. I haven't put the years beside them because, again, I didn't have time to do this. Conservation District, Cape Cod National Seashore, the State Coastal Zone Management Committee, Town Resource Officer, Public Works, and the Center Coastal for the Studies. We need 7 there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You'll notice there's only 6, so I was able to give you an optional member list to choose from because we do need one more. And I think the Department of Ecological Restoration, Beth Lambert would probably be my personal opinion, would be the best choice for that. So that would move her up into the 1 of the 7. So take this list home, talk about it. Do not contact each other or me. If you want to write certain names in here or move things around, you can let Owen know ahead of the meeting. Or if not, I will come next week prepared with this same sheet. And basically, we will take formal actions and a vote then.
Just a question then. These are the individuals that are currently in these positions.
There's nobody currently in this. This is a brand new committee.
This is a brand new one.
Right. Brand
so new. These are just suggestions.
These are suggestions.
Okay.
These are people that we reached out to and asked, and I do believe that they have responded that they will would like to serve, especially in the ones in the center area. I'm not too sure about the alternative. Members, if they've been contacted or not, but certainly once we come up with some names, then I'll write, draft a letter and send it out. And if people
the conservation district, that's the USDA program.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I know where you're, Jack.
Do you have any input on this, Jack? Or do you? You don't?
No.
And all these people who already...
To my acknowledgement, some have been contacted, but again, I didn't want to do things one individual at a time. I wanted to kind of get a blanket. Some have been, some haven't been yet.
Ray Jacks is also on the Water Protection Collaborative, so I know he has quite a bit of experience. He's head of the DPW in Falmouth. That's the only one I recognize.
So are you okay with that?
Mm-hmm. We'll bring Department back of Ecological year. Restoration, is that state?
I do believe it is, yes. Mm-hmm.
Beth Lambert?
Yeah. I mean, I've known Ted for years, too, from Chatham, but I don't have any problems with any of these people, so
no, I don't.
I'm trying to just...
I'm just trying to picture...
I'm trying to move it forward.
No, yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I mean, these are all great, dedicated, very intelligent people,
yes.
And especially in the coastal area, so right. I'm just trying to move this thing forward, so...
As well as we should.
All right, so yep. No action as of now, but we'll certainly... I'll put it on the agenda again for next week, and we will... definitely be prepared to take some action. And this again allows me to bring it up again at the assembly meeting this afternoon, so I can pressure them to also give us a formal nominee.
I just think John is a John Omen and not an Omen.
Yeah.
You know,
well, I don't know.
I wasn't even going
was
to go there. I wasn't going to go there.
Oh, okay.
But if you want me to,
no,
thank you
fine.
For giving me the opportunity. I did this at 5:30 this morning. You're lucky I spelled my own.
Right?
Yeah, you're lucky I spelled my own name right. I don't even think I spelled Christy's name right, and Mike, I don't even think I spelled your name right. But I did it at 5:30 this morning.
It's anyone else.
So I'm like, you know. But thank you for catching me on it. You always got to catch me, don't you?
Well, it's just that it could be somebody else. There might be an omen,
there
and not
go.
An omen.
Alrighty. We'll move on. New business, I have none. Now we go to the commissioner's actions. There's authorization and execution of a contract. I'd be looking for someone to move to authorize the execution of a contract for a grant from the United States Economic Development Administration to the Cape Cod Commission in the amount of $70,000 for a period of July 1st, 2018 through June 30th, 2021, to develop and implement a regional comprehensive economic development strategy,
so
as
moved.
Presented.
So
second.
Moved.
Just question.
Move in a second. Do we have anyone here to answer the question? Mm-hmm. We do.
The 70,000. Is it 70,000 every year, or does it go up or down?
It is 70,000 every year. We get the money. That contract is for 3 years, but the money is only for one, and then we'll have subsequent 2 years,
okay.
And then we go through the process again.
Thanks.
People at home hear that? All righty. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Authorization approval of use for the grounds. I'd be looking for someone to move to authorize the ground use request by American Cancer Society to utilize the County Cahoot Complex for the start and finish of their annual Making Strides Against Breast Cancer event on Sunday, October 14, 2018, subject to the county use policy, including but not limited to proof of insurance, post-event cleanup, and other provisions set forth by the facilities director/assistant county administrator as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any questions on this one?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 That brings us to an authorization of execution of a contract for the Cape Cod Foundation. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the execution of a contract for a subaward from the Cape Cod Foundation through Tufts Health Plan Foundation, Inc., in the amount of $121,520 for a period of July 1st, 2018 through June 30th, 2020, as presented.
So moved.
Second. Question?
Yes, anybody here to answer this? Thank you. Come on up.
What does $121,520 cover?
The $121,000 is actually the full amount for the two-year grant that the Cape Cod Foundation received. We're actually, and it's kind of divided up, there's a larger chunk of funding, somewhere around $80,000 or so in year one. Cape Cod Foundation, as the fiscal agent for the contract, will retain 4% for administrative costs. Approximately 55,000
$234.07 will be to contract Vera Harik to do the regional plans, the assessments with the 15 towns, as well as a region-wide plan. As part of that first year chunk of funding, there would also be a project assistant separately contracted. So, and then I'm sorry, the last chunk of funding would be for year two for Vera to complete those plans. So what I actually have for you today, even though it's that number referenced, the 121, is for the full 2 years. This subcontract that you have today is just for Vera Harik, for her work that she would be doing in year one.
Is this related to the healthy aging presentation that was given 2 weeks ago?
Yes, sir. Yep. Yeah, so they're gonna individually contract with Vera for this work for this year as well as for next year.
They are. Or we are.
They are. We are with Cape Cod Foundation for this kind of joint project here.
So should this language in the motion say to authorize and execute a contract for a portion of the subaward?
That may be more appropriate, and maybe the specific subcontract amount could be referenced, the 55, 234, and 7 cents. That may be better representation of what's actually.
I'm sorry, what's the amount again?
$55,234.07.
And this is for salaries?
Yes.
It's not salaries, it's a personnel contract.
Yes, and there's of that, $4,312.50 is for project-related expenses such as supplies and travel. I can give you those additional, details.
I'm going to put that in as presented.
Okay.
Because I can't have all that in the motion, it'd
okay.
be too much.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the motion is going to be changed now to say to authorize the execution of a contract for a portion of the subaward from the Cape Cod Foundation through the Tufts Health Plan, Inc., in the amount of $55,234.07 for the period of July 1st, 2018 through June 30th, 2020.
This amount would be just for this first year, so it would be July 1st, 18 through June 30th of 19.
Okay.
And then next year we'll do an additional contract for that fiscal year.
Do you want me to do a say
friendly amendment?
Yeah, friendly amendment.
Yeah.
Okay, so the person who made the amendment and seconded both agreed to the language of the friendly amendment. So,
excellent.
Okay.
All right.
It does say as presented too, so I think we're covered that whatever contract we're signing today is reflected that this board has agreed to it under this motion.
Excellent.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
Anything else?
We have to vote.
Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Thank you.
Now we have to create a fund for this. So this is I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the creation of a new fund for a portion of a subaward from the Cape Cod Foundation through Tufts Health Plan Foundation, Inc., in the amount of, and I'm going to use the amount that we voted, $55,234.07 for a period of July 1st, 2018 through June 30th, 2019, as presented.
This is 2020.
I know it, but
okay.
I have to change it because
gotcha. Okay.
We changed the motion above.
Yep, gotcha. So moved.
Second.
They moved in second, and if there's any problems with this, we can always come back and what do you call it, change any language.
Hand it out.
But, yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, that brings us to authorization of creation of a new fund. For a contract with the town of Orleans. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the creation of a new fund for a contract with the town of Orleans to render sanitation services in the amount of $31,900 for the period of July 1st, 2018 through June 30th, 2019, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved in second. Anybody here for this one? What are we doing now, pumping their toilets for them?
What are we doing in the area of
sanitation? What are we doing for $31,000?
This has been a contract that's been in place over many years, and we, through the Health and Environment Department, and Sean couldn't make it today, so I've been working with the town of Orleans and doing all the fiscal management for it. And
is there some better language we use than other than rendering sanitation services?
We have a sanitarians who provide service to the town of Orleans, so I would have to defer to Sean on that.
Next year it should say health department personnel.
Okay. Sounds good.
Do you know how many people ask me, I'm serious, do you know how many people ask me, are we seriously pumping
I don't think that they're
septic systems for town of Orleans now? Why can't you do our town?
Renting health department sanitation services.
The actual work, scope of work that our staff does for them, I'm not privy to. I don't have a job description for what the sanitarians do. But I know that they've been successful in the past, and
yeah,
it's ongoing.
Like, say, helping the Board of Health and doing something.
Yes, working with the Board of Health.
Question. Is Orleans the only town we provide these services to? No? There are others?
Provincetown.
We haven't had a contract with them lately.
We have one in Howard, too, don't we?
Yes.
Send some people out there to do stuff.
Yes.
Oh. Okay.
So this helps support the salary for the people to go out there.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
For years in the Summit County supported Boards of Health across the Cape.
Yeah.
Because of rapid increase in demand. Yeah.
So we're not in the septic pumping business.
No.
No.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Authorize a renewal of a contract with Pro Couriers. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize a renewal of a contract with Pro Couriers to provide courier services to the Water Quality Laboratory for a period of one additional year from July 1st, 2018. June 30th, 2019, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Authorization execution of discharges of mortgages. I'm looking for someone to authorize the execution of discharge of a mortgage by James L. Kennedy, Barstow County, acting by and through the Cape Cod Commission, dated June 5th, 2001, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Commissioner's reports. So the only thing I have is two things.
What about H?
I'm sorry, which was H?
Septic betterments. Authorizing the execution of the certificates for dissolving septic betterments.
Didn't even print off. Excellent. Yes. Yeah, all right, I'll put that in here. H. Looking for someone to move the authorization of the chair to sign the, let me get the language, thank you. Authorizing the chair to execute the certificates of dissolving septic betterments.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Yeah.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Mr. B, do you have any reports?
No.
Ms. Glenn?
No.
Let me just write this down. I must have printed off the, either that, you know what, but the H came out on my, on page 3 and I left it in my printer at 5:30 this morning. Thank you for catching that.
We'll call you at 4:30.
Yeah, there you go. The only thing I have that I'd like to bring up is contemplating scheduling a workshop with the county commissioners and the Human Rights Commission. It has come to my attention as early as actually this morning, so I don't want to discuss it here today, but it just has come to my attention that we have had yet again some of the interim human rights director and even a intern actually resign. So we have some ongoing conflicts. My question only in scheduling, nothing to do with the topic because again I don't want to violate open meeting law, only in scheduling. Would my fellow commissioners be interested in either attending or having me put on a formal workshop similar to what we have done for the creation of the different ordinances that we've brought forward, where we meet in this room and we discuss things and move forward in regards to the future of the Human Rights Commission?
Yes.
And who would we meet with the
us
commission?
And the commissioners of the Human Rights Commission.
Okay.
Yes.
Second.
So you fine with that?
Yeah.
Okay, would you rather it on a Wednesday?
Yeah.
Would it be easier for you on a Wednesday?
Yeah.
Just like maybe right after?
Yeah.
Right, so let me reach out to them. Again, I'm only talking on scheduling now because I don't want any violations of the open meeting law, only on scheduling. We'll reach out to them and see if maybe we can have them come in, maybe even next Wednesday, because it's a non-assembly day. And even if we have to, we'll look at some times with them, because it might be advantageous for us to move our meeting ahead a little bit, if they can meet in early afternoon, and then we can just segue from this meeting right into theirs, and you won't have to wait around for an hour or something. We'll work that out. And if not, through Owen, I will reach out to you guys with some other scheduling dates.
Okay.
So that's all I have on that. Jack?
Well, I loved your play on words with sanitation. When I was in junior high, I used to clean my father's office, which meant basically emptying the waste basket, sweeping up and cleaning the toilets.
So you were sanitarian.
I was just going to say, years later, I was doing a little resume in high school, and I asked Dad, what do I call what I did for you? He says, call yourself a sanitation engineer. Yeah, so... just a few things regarding the fire academy. We, Steve and I, attended a meeting at the water board, Hyannis Water Board, yesterday. I would say it was a very positive meeting. The exchange was good. They had some questions that we were able to answer. We came away with a pretty good feeling that we were going in the right direction in partnership with the Hyannis Water Board. Subsequent to that, we went upstairs for a conservation hearing before the Bonsall Conservation Commission. It was not as pleasant. We withdrew our request for a notice of activity determination, and moved on to, we will file an NOI with them at some point in the future to talk about the next steps at the Fire Training Academy. In the meantime, I'll be providing them with a little more historical background on the academy. I think there were things there were conclusions being made that weren't relevant and appropriate under the circumstances, and I want to try to clarify that. Tomorrow night, Steve and I, and I believe Marshall Cohen, will be attending the Bonsall Town Council hearing at the request of Mark Hales to, again, answer questions on where we are with the Fire Training Academy for the town councilors. So,
they're having a hearing on it?
Yes.
Which usually means that they're passing an ordinance or something. So what kind of hearing?
No, Mark just asked us to come in and do an update.
This is in front of all the commissioners. All the
councils. So it's just a presentation.
Just an update. Yep. On the early retirement plan, I continue to lobby. I'm sending stuff up every day to Sarah Peak and Chairman Spiliotis. I'm not hearing much back. I know it's hectic up there right now. You all know that. We haven't got a budget, and we haven't got a lot of...
So what's your feeling about it passing?
I'm not an optimist at this point. Feedback I'm getting is it's not something that the chairman likes to do, early retirements. But I'm going to keep going at it. I know. I'm not going to comment on it beyond that. But we'll keep pushing. That's all we can do. So... and lastly, I want to say I had the opportunity to stand in for the chairman last week at Pizza Eating Countess. On the way home.
Pizza eating?
Yeah, and the pizza eating. It was a fundraiser for the Hyannis Hawks that Judy Scarafile runs every year. On the way home run, I wanted to stop at the Big and Tall store, Hodges Big and Tall, and have them put an elastic in my shorts. But it was still a great event. So.
Thank you.
And your son was nice enough to buy you pizza when you got
home. That was a great surprise. It's still sitting there.
Where's the tea go?
Just a brief update on the dread product that I brought in front of you last week. We still have no update on if they received their permit yet for the emergency permit for the next Chatham job. So I just want to keep you guys in the loop on it. We discussed it last week. Still waiting to hear back from it, but we haven't heard anything back from the town.
And that's the one the sand shift is going to be handling?
Yes, correct. So we're just waiting to hear back. So they're currently on Mill Creek right now with the old dredge, and they should be wrapping that up probably Monday. And then we're kind of on a hold pattern, waiting for to see what happens with them, if they get their permit or not, the emergency permit. So hopefully they do, and we'll move the sand shifters down there now. I think it's like one bay over, but it's down like in the general area of where it needs to be. So
yeah, but that's not I think last week that's not out of the ordinary. It takes a couple weeks for an emergency permit to go through.
I actually think, Ron, to be honest with you, I think it's they've been working on it for almost 2 months, and that's been an issue just with the ongoing permit, and hopefully working with the Cape Cod Commission, we'll be able to
find a kind of a cleaner way of getting the permits processed. Yeah. There's just, there's too many agencies involved, and it just becomes like you have to get, you know, the I dotted here, your T crossed there, and then you got to go back.
State.
Yeah, so yeah. I think that working with Christy and her team, I think we're going to find a way that we, to not simplify the process, but maybe combine the efforts so everything gets out. Yeah. So that's what we're hoping to do with the agreement that we have with them now. So, but I just wanted to keep you guys in the loop on what was going on there.
Thank you. Anything else? Any other staff? Seeing none. You're looking for motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded, and it is 11:06. Thank you.
Thank you.